Welcome to part two of our Real World Faith series. We started this series last week, and really what we want to do, what we're endeavoring to do this summer, is to help us to grow in faith, faith that will be strong. Just by a show of hands this morning, how many of you planted gardens this spring into the summer? A number of you, I see a few hands. Oh yeah, okay, a few more going on. You planted a garden, I'm among you. Isn't it exciting to watch that garden grow? It's exciting to watch the garden grow and see it take root. And the plants, we've got a zucchini that's ready for us to pick. We've got some tomatoes that are just about ready to start picking and enjoying. And that's what we wanted to do this summer, is to see your faith grow, to challenge you to grow your faith to a place where it's strong, where it can survive in the real world, and even thrive in the real world. So the question that we really want to answer this summer as we dive into this series is, how can we have a faith that will thrive in the real world? Put that question up on the PowerPoint for you. How can we have a faith that can not just survive, but can thrive? If they've got that, you can put it up there. It'll come. I'm sure it will. This world is filled with difficult times. We talked and prayed for some people who are going through difficult situations this morning. Terrible things do happen in this world. Terrible things happen to us as believers. And we ourselves, we face sickness, we face death, and we're not exempt to that. So how can our faith survive and thrive in that type of atmosphere? You know, this world, every time you turn on the news, you hear about another area of corruption in government or in business, and you've got, who can we trust? Who can you trust? The world is filled with corruption, it seems, and you look around and all kinds of people are doing things that it just blows your mind, some of the things that people are doing, because everyone just seems to do what is right in their own eyes. And so we ask ourselves this question: how can we have faith that will thrive in the real world? How can you pass on a faith to your children and your grandchildren that will thrive in this type of environment? You know yourself, those that you put up your hands that said you're gardeners, you know, there are many things that are trying to get at your fruits and vegetables. You know, there's pests and bugs and disease, and you have to water it, take care of it every day, but you also have to ward off some of those other things that would want to take that. Well, it's like that with our faith. We need to prepare our faith and take care of our faith. And that's where we're going with this series, is developing a faith. And so last week we started off in Daniel 1, and we're going to go back to Daniel 1 in your Bibles if you want to begin to turn there or in your Bible or your device. And we're going to look at it. So last week we talked about Daniel is a great example to us, because he was a man that demonstrated that he had a highly complex faith, a faith that would see him through the things of this life and the challenges that were there. And he said, you know, even the circumstance that Daniel found himself in, that wasn't a commentary on God's love, but that was a situation that was there that he had to overcome with his faith. And so I wanted to say to you, you too can have a highly developed faith. You can grow in your faith. And so we looked at this background, and when we introduced ourselves to Daniel, we saw that, you know, Daniel had just been taken captive and carried off by this brutal leader who had, you know, basically destroyed his home, his country, taken him from his family, and, you know, things looked pretty bleak. And in the natural, it would be natural for Daniel to think, where are you, God? Where are you, God? It's natural for Daniel to think that maybe God didn't exist, or that God had forgotten about him. But the truth is, and the Bible explains this to us, that people have been warned that this was going to happen. They've been warned ahead of time, and God just wanted the people to turn back to him. And so God had not gone anywhere. God had brought this situation in order to draw his people back to him, to correct his people that had strayed from him. And it was God's determination that Daniel and that the people of Israel that would come back to the Lord. And so we see Daniel here, in the midst of this terrible situation, him and a few friends who have determined that they will follow God even despite the situation. And quickly, in the very first chapter, we see the tension that arises, that he comes face to face with the pressure, the temptation, whether to please God or to please those that were now in authority over him, to take the enticing things that the world had to offer, that the king was offering them, the kind of bribes in some situations, some incentives, if you want to put it in nicer terms, to follow and to do this culture that the king wanted these people to assimilate into. He wanted them to be absorbed into this culture and to become loyal to him. And you'll see this over and over in the book of Daniel, where there's the compromise, option to compromise his will. But Daniel here demonstrates some divine strength. Doesn't do what is natural. Because in the natural, most of us would just want to give in to those temptations. And temptations surround us every day, don't they? Temptations to do what the world and this culture would have us do rather than what God has called us to do. But in the natural, we would be tempted to. But Daniel doesn't do the natural. We see Daniel does what is supernatural. And God wants to do a supernatural work through us. He wants us to do what is supernatural. He will help us. Anyone who puts their trust in the Lord can do it. Okay? This is what I want you to get today as we study the book of Daniel. Daniel is not the exception. No, Daniel is an example to us. The reason Daniel is put in the Word of God is an example so that we as well can follow his example, follow the Word of God, and we can live like Daniel lived. So if you've got your Bibles, if you turn there, turn to chapter 1 in Daniel. We're going to start today. We left off at verse 7. We're going to jump back in to verse 8 this morning. Verse 8, Daniel chapter 1 says this. But Daniel was determined not to defile himself by eating the food and wine given to them by the king. He asked the chief of staff for permission not to eat the unacceptable food. Now God had given the chief of staff both respect and affirmation for Daniel. He had affection for Daniel. He looked at Daniel in a positive light. But, the Bible says, he responded this way. I'm afraid of my Lord the King, who has ordered that you eat this food and wine. If you guys become pale in comparison to the other youths your age, I'm afraid the king will have you. And at this point, you think, well, Daniel could have said, and his friends, well, hey, we gave it a shot. We tried. We went to the big man in charge here, and we said to him, you know, we don't want to defile ourselves. And the guy even likes you, but, you know, he said no. He's just too afraid of the king. But we don't see them give up at this point. In fact, the Bible says in verse 11 here that Daniel spoke with the attendant who had been appointed by the chief of staff to look after Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And he says to them, please test us for 10 days on a diet of vegetables and water, Daniel said. And at the end of the 10 days, see how we look compared to the other young men who are eating the king's food. Then, make your decision in light of what you see. The attendant agreed to Daniel's suggestion and to test the men for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, Daniel and his three friends looked healthier and better nourished than the young men who had eaten the food the king had assigned to them. So, after that, the attendant fed them only vegetables instead of the food and the wine provided for the others. And God gave these four young men an unusual aptitude to understanding every aspect of literature and wisdom. And God gave Daniel a special ability to interpret the meaning of visions and dreams. And when the training period was over, that was ordered by the king, was over and complete, the chief of staff brought all the men to King Nebuchadnezzar. And the king talked with them, and no one impressed him as much as Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And so they entered the royal service. And when the king consulted them in matters that were regarding wisdom and balanced judgment, he found them 10 times, the Bible says, 10 times more capable than any of the magicians or enchanters, those that were working in his entire kingdom. We just thank God this morning. Thank you, Lord, for this example that you've placed in your word. An example that we are called to today. Thank you for the example of our youth this morning. Father, we pray that today our hearts would be challenged, and that our faith would grow, and we would endeavor to do what you have called us to do. We thank you, Lord. Amen. How impressive is that? That's a pretty impressive story. It would be pretty impressive for any of us to have a testimony like that. But even more so, I find, because we know that these were youth. And, you know, not that youth should be any less. In fact, many times they're much more zeal. But, you know, he doesn't have, like, life experience to say, you know, well, which he will have later on in the book, to say, here's what God did, and he's proved himself over and over. But here, from a very young age, we look and we see that he determined that to follow God. It starts with determination. Verse 8 says, but Daniel determined not to defile himself. He committed himself to the truth of God's word, to having God's word in his heart. So the very first point I want to draw out for us this morning is that faith that thrives in the real world starts with a heart that's turned towards God. A faith that will thrive in this world, in this environment that we find ourselves, starts when your heart is turned towards God. And I'm so proud of our youth. I sat there just listening to them, how this missions trip impacted their lives, and it was great to hear. How many thought it was great to hear from them this morning? Yeah. Amen. It was so great to hear about that. That's just the tip of the iceberg. And Pastor Josh alluded to it earlier, that this was just what we saw in this missions trip and their fundraisers, and what they did was only like 90% of what really happened. Because what really happened was like this iceberg, that it was, most of it was unseen. It went behind the scenes. And unless you were here on a Wednesday night, or unless you had one of these young people in your home, you probably didn't know how much preparation and work went into them going finally to the Dominican Republic. That was just the tip of the iceberg. See, for 10 months, these young people in our congregation whose heart were turned towards God, who said to themselves, this is important to me. I want my faith to be strong. And so I'm willing to go and to give 10 months of my life to coming to the church during the week, meeting in a small group and studying God's word, and then having assignments that I have to go and do during the week and studying God's word on my own, even writing papers that they would have to turn in about subjects and about things that they were studying. They committed themselves to mentoring relationships. They committed themselves to praying daily, and even to times of prayer and fasting. These were all things that were involved in their discipleship program that Pastor Josh took them through. They committed themselves to listening to God and journaling what God was saying to them. In fact, they had to take notes on 2 sermons every week. So probably Friday night and Sunday, and if they missed one of those, they probably had to find a podcast somewhere and listen to that and take notes on that. They limited, so not only did they prepare and do extra things, but then they limited their exposure to what the world was offering to them. And so they limited their exposure to screen time, television, devices, to 10 hours for the week. They devoted themselves to only listening to music that would encourage their faith, to build up their faith. You know, for youth, most of them, music is a big deal. And music is, you know, a thing that you share with your peers. And so they said, you know, we're going to listen to music that's going to build up our faith. So they devoted themselves to all of this. And long before they went to the Dominican Republic to show God's love there, they committed themselves to showing God's love here in practical ways. One of those things was going to a homeless shelter and volunteering there. And so I commend those youth today because they're an example to us, aren't they? They're an example. And they invested, yeah. But that choice started right here. It started in their hearts. It was a heart decision that said, I will want to devote myself to growing in my faith. I want to give myself to doing it. And that's what these 4 young men did in the Bible. They devoted themselves. They would not compromise. It was in their hearts. And even though there was opposition, they would fulfill that law. And I look at, you know, many of our young people who go off to colleges and universities and the temptations. I've seen it as my own young people, my own children have gone off to education. And there's tremendous pressures, to compromise, tremendous pressure. And I remember myself going to community college and the pressure that was there. And I was so thankful that before I ever went to community college, that I had a divine encounter with Jesus Christ that held me through those times. And I'm thankful for people that are ministering on our campuses, like one of our own missionaries, Trevor and Rebecca, who are on the campus just over here at Humber College and are making a place that our youth that can go and worship the Lord and encourage them in following God. And I think that if you are determined as a young person to follow the Lord, even in a world in like our campuses that are so against God, that your faith can thrive even there. Like Daniel and his friends, if you are determined in your heart, you'll filter everything that comes your way through this word. You'll filter everything you hear, everything you see, and every opportunity, you'll filter that through God's word. If in your heart you are determined that you are going to follow God. And so the Bible encourages us in Proverbs chapter 4 that we are to guard our hearts. We are to guard our hearts. It says, above all else, above everything else, guard your heart. For it determines the course of your life. Because if you lose your heart, you lose that basic part of you that is thinking and responding and motivating you in the proper way. So it says, guard your heart. And Daniel and his friends guarded their heart. And I believe if we guard our hearts, that God will help us through that. But you know, we've got so many excuses, don't we? Why we allow sin to creep in. We've got excuses. We say, yeah, but I don't have time to read my Bible today. But, you know, the Bible really doesn't say anything about that. But, you know, if I take a stand, people think I'm a Jesus freak, and they'll think I'm a religious freak of some sort. Maybe you're being challenged at work to compromise in some way. You say, but if I don't do that, you know, I won't get promoted. If I don't do that, maybe I'll even lose my job, but When we really think about it, who do you want on your side? You want to be on God's side and have God's provision? Or do you want, you know, just on the side of a human boss who can't do anything to a child of God unless God allows it? But, we have all these buts. In fact, this room is filled with buts, right? And for me, it's a little bit uncomfortable today to talk about buts, so I brought a friend along. His name's Steve, and Steve's going to talk a little more about our buts this morning.
Got a big butt.
Turn it up a little bit.
Just checking in, find out if you want to know. And you know what? The funny thing is, I got several big butts. And before you discard me or wince at the disgusting notion of that, I'm going to go out on a limb here and suggest that possibly you have at least one big butt as well. Yeah, you like that? Hurts a little, no? Let me tell you something. Let me just tell you something, okay? Everybody we know has a big butt. And more often than not, there's something that actually gets in the way of us living a consistent life for Jesus. Yeah, I think you know what I'm talking about. I'm going to expound a little bit, okay? See if you can recognize some of these buttons. But I have to work, but my favorite TV shows, but my kids have practice, but I got to tweet something. But it's such a beautiful day, but I'm just a little mood, but I deserve a break today. You see, everything kind of interferes with my life of just living an authentic life for God. And more often than not, it always has something to do with some sort of butt. Okay, even the littlest butt can distract me. It really can. The littlest butt can make me think, I'm not going to pray today. I'm not going to think about it today. I'm not going to deny myself. I'm not going to read the Bible, blah, blah, blah. Whatever God asks me to do, I'll seem to have a butt for it and get away. Okay, and the most tremendously big butt of all time is the butt that gets in the way of me just hanging out with God and reading His Word. It's true. Think about it. All the times you're about to open that, and all of a sudden the big giant butt gets in the way. But, much like one of these. But I got a farm, but I'm tired, but the kids are tired, but I read last Tuesday, but I got to check Facebook, but I don't like religious, but it's too hot, but I just don't like books, but I don't understand it, but it's boring. But what does that have to do with me in the 21st century? Those are some ugly butts, people. So call them what they are, ugly. Ugly butts, okay? And there's a lot more to them, sad but true. Here's a list, although not exhaustive, of some of the most popular butts known. But I don't have enough money yet. But others will think that I'm a nerd if I carry the Bible. But they will like me if I talk about Jesus. But I don't know if God will do what I ask. But I just can't get motivated. But I'm afraid. But I don't have all the answers. But a small thing is the same thing as Monday Night Football. But can't I just let my life speak for itself? But I'm not happy. That's not my gift. That's the pastor job. But I don't know how to do it. But I can't believe that. But I don't know where to start. But everybody else is having fun. Butts about, friend. But. Here a butt, there a butt. Everywhere a butt. Okay? And the most overused butt of all time. But I just don't have enough time. Oh, come on, we have a lot of buts. God has given us a real simple word, okay? If we learn it, and we share it, and we teach it, and we live by it, and see, God gets glorified, people benefit, and then we get blessed. That's why we do what we do. That's the why behind the butt, okay? And ultimately, that's the whole point I'm trying to make here, my fellow butt lovers, is if your butt is bigger than your why, then your butt's too big. Okay, it's time to, metaphorically speaking, snap into a swim gym. Okay, let's slap on some spiritual shape-ups and hit the road a little bit so we can just manage the butts a little bit. That's all we're trying to do. That's what we're talking about. Let's minimize the excuses. Let's shrink the butts. Shrink the butts. Say it with me. Shrink the butts. That's what we need to do. And you and I can do that together. We can conquer this. You and I can do it. We start today, okay? I know we can. Let's just do it. No ifs, ands, or...
Thanks, Steve. Well, let's say it with me. We will shrink the butts. We will shrink the butts. Come on, say it like you mean it. We will shrink the butts. Turn to your neighbor and say, you can shrink the butt. Just encourage them this morning. I believe if we will shrink the butts, if we'll just determine in our hearts to follow God no matter what comes our way. Because I think that Daniel and his friends had determined that they would not defile themselves and life was really good. And, you know, they could do whatever they wanted. But now, in comes this dictator and they're taken captive. And now they have to change their game plan. But if we commit ourselves to living godly lives, the kind of lives that God wants, then we open ourselves to His sustaining power and His support. If we will just won't compromise but really commit ourselves. And I love what Daniel does here when he goes to the attendant and says to him, so test us. Test us for 10 days. Because commitment is always tested. Commitment is always tested. And so Daniel is open to the test, and he invites the test. He invites this test into his life. He says, you know, test us for 10 days and see if we're not better. In fact, my challenge to you today is, why don't you do the same thing? Why don't you invite a change into your life and invite the testing and test yourself for 10 days. Do a 10-day test. If you're struggling with some area of your life, maybe you're not reading God's word, maybe you're struggling with gossip, or maybe you're struggling with anger or pornography, test yourself for 10 days and don't take in what this world has to offer, but commit yourself, devote yourself to God's diet. Take daily portions of the Word of God, absorb that into your life, put the other aside for 10 days, and then ask yourself if you're not more healthier for it, if you don't look better than all those that are around you. I challenge you this week to do that for 10 days. And if you fail partway through it, that's right, just start again for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, look back and examine your life and see if it's not better. And then if it is, why don't you go on and do it for 30 days?
Fine.
And then 60 days. And do it. Determine your heart. Secondly this morning, faith that thrives in the real world is set in a mind committed to God. So it goes from their heart to their mind. From their heart to their mind. They start to plan. You see them here, you know, it's not only that they determine their heart, but I love that they then make a plan on what to do. I can picture Daniel and his friends just huddled in the corner now that their plan has changed. They had planned to honor God. These are the only four that are mentioned out of all the people that are taken captive. These are the only four that are mentioned that are going to honor God. That's part of the reason that God allows this nation to be taken. But now their plan has changed. So they have to replan this. Okay, well, you know what? The chief, he seems to like you, Daniel. You seem to have found favor. He has some affection for you. He's been kind to you. Why don't you go to him and ask? And so they're hoping for the best. They go to the chief of all the staff, and they ask him. And we see their rejection right off. He's afraid of the king. He's afraid he's got to answer to the king, and the king has not got a good reputation. He's afraid he's going to be beheaded. So Daniel, they don't give up at that point. Even though they faced rejection, they didn't give up. And the Bible says, then they made another plan. And they went on and they talked to the chief, the official that had been placed over them. And this time, they come with a plan for a test. Why don't you just test us? And this time, they found favor in the test work. But they didn't stop there. That wasn't the stop of their work. They actually worked hard. I can imagine them saying, okay, make sure you eat lots of vegetables, you know, and I can see Daniel saying to Hananiah, you know, I'm going to the gym again. Okay, I'm gonna pump some weights. See, I need a spotter, come along with me. And they go, yeah, because we gotta look good. At the end of these 10 days, we've gotta look good so we can keep this diet going. And not only that, you know, they had to look good at the end of 3 years is how long this training went on for. And that brings me to my final point this morning about building our faith. Faith that thrives in the real world is a hands-on faith that will set you apart to be used and blessed by God. It's hands-on. It's hands-on. It's tangible, that kind of faith. Philippians chapter 2 says that we are to work hard to show the results of your salvation. Work hard, obeying the Lord, deep reverence and fear. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. You know, some of you here, I can tell just by looking at you, some of you work out, right? Some of you work out. You go to the gym and you grab those barbells. And this is my weak arm session.
Oh, yeah.
All right. But you lift those weights so that your muscles can be strong, right? So that you can be healthy. And how do you feel after you work out? How do you feel? Good, yeah. Tired, yes. So you feel good. Yeah, you know you did something good for yourself. But if you've done it right, you're gonna feel fatigued. Your muscles are gonna hurt a little bit. They're gonna be tired. And I listened to the youth here talking today about how they were stretched, how it was hard sometimes. But that's how you grow a faith. That's how you grow a faith that will survive and thrive in the real world. Is you've got to work at it. And it's gonna hurt sometimes. It's not gonna be always easy. You're gonna feel some stretching, some fatigue, like I feel right now. Right? But you've gotta work at it. And sometimes it will be tough. Sometimes God will stretch you. In the hardest ways. But He's growing your faith. He's causing your faith to grow. And in case I'm scaring you today, let me just end with this, reminding us that there is blessing. There is blessing in a faith that is grown, that a faith that is strong, a faith that thrives. God blesses His people who are totally committed, who are living uncompromising lives. So Lord, in verse 18, we see that these young men who are brought before the king are, they pass the first test, and then 3 years later, they pass the test before the king. They see that they are at the top of their class. And the king himself says, you know what, these guys are 10 times better. I'm so impressed with these four young men. They are 10 times better than anyone else. And he brings them into his personal service. God gives these four young men a place of influence over an entire nation. They have the ear of the king, and the king is listening to their advice because they did it God's way, and God honored that, and they were blessed through it. And the word I have for you today is that if you will commit yourself to doing it God's way, devote yourself to not corrupting your life, but standing guard over your heart and working at it, if you live a pure and righteous life, full of character, full of godly character, even the world itself will take knowledge of you, will see that God is doing something in your life, and that it can be done. It is possible for us to live a life that God will bless. We put ourselves in a position that God will bless our lives. How incredible it would be if I come to your work, you invite me out for lunch, which you should, and you introduce me to your boss, and I shake hands with your boss, and he just says, yeah. And he puts your name in there, is one of my very best employees. In fact, they're 10 times better than anyone else doing that job. And that's the way it should be for us. God wants to do a great work in us. Would you bow your heads this morning? I want to pray for you. I want to pray that you will set your heart, determine in your heart today that you're going to grow a faith over this summer. That you're going to grow your faith that will be a blessing. Put yourself in a place that God can bless you. Amen. Determine in your mind. Begin to make plans. Like I mentioned today, to take those 10 days, the next 10 days. You know in your heart what needs to be removed from your life. You know in your heart the things you need to do in order to build your faith. Perhaps today you need to turn your heart towards God. You could do that today. You can give him your life. Begin a new journey with Jesus. Set in your mind what you're going to do. And then exercise your faith. Start to work it out. Start to do the things that God has asked you. All across this room today, if there's some part of this message that spoke to you, just raise your hand. This is before God, all over this place. My hand is raised. That's preparing it. It spoke to me. There's things in my life I need to do to make it stronger faith. Let me pray. God, you saw the hands raised here today. You see our hearts. Father, as we determine to follow hard after you, Lord, that you would give us the strength we need. Give us supernatural strength and ability, Father, so that we can show ourselves and prove that we can follow you. Lord, we just thank you, God, for your presence that's in this place. We thank you, Jesus, that you are here today, speaking into our hearts, and speaking through your word to us today. Take a moment, you stand all across the rest. They're going to lead us in one song as we finish here today. Just allow the Holy Spirit.